subjective personality, 3 years on. Okay, question one. What is your average day week like? Well, viewing from the outside, I would say it's a good life by anyone's metrics. There's a lot of freedom to make choices. There's pretty good balance across a wide spectrum of areas of interest. And there are stresses like most people would have, but I would say the stresses are definitely more first world than survival related. But if I go deeper and view it from my needs, my lens, well, I would say the average day week like is an awkward cocktail where you've got one part feels very much in control, working to a commitment, a long-term commitment. But then you've got another part which is seeking to constantly coexist with the change to plan, which is always fun and interesting. You know, children grow. I see quite progressive evolution in, you know, every couple months, and that requires change, and you either join the ride or you don't. And then the other part is the balance of commitments. I mean, myself, I'm a father, husband, individual. I'm also a provider, so seeking to work around the needs and wants of all those areas is can be challenging at times. And so overall, you know, it's a good life. So then why am I seeking more? Why am I looking to dive further in? Well, it's because the missing element of the cocktail is more time for myself. And don't get me wrong, I've got lots of time for myself, but where I struggle with is in the average day week, like, is the time for self-inquiry. It's not something for me that is straightforward turn on and off, you know, like playing a computer game or whatever, you go on, you leave. In the end, what I'm seeking to change my average day week like week is to create pockets where I can take advantage of the opportunities when those moments for self-inquiry allow themselves to arise, and have a more flexible approach to permit that, and I think that's what will take things from good to excellent. Not that there's a goal of being excellent, it's just more that I can see the importance of having that in the average day or week. I would feel proud to be able to say that that is integrated as a habit, just like waking up and drinking water. Okay, question two. Tell us about one of the most stressful times in your life. there's been quite a few incidents recently that have really highlighted to me things that I get frustrated about. I mean, I've just come back from a 9-day camping trip, and there's some things that have happened. You know, physical suffering is something that I struggle with, much more so than mental suffering. I can go on and on with that, but the physical, I've got a low tolerance, and I don't know if it's the typed MM play or not, but if we talk about the stressful times I've had one recently as of maybe three months ago, and it caused me a lot of grief to the point where it was occupying a lot of my thoughts during the day, and then I'd come home and I'd constantly talk about the situation to my partner, and in the moment it felt like there was this constant drama about the situation, new information that had to be processed and discussed, planned how to move forward. And now 3 months on, where everything's solved, was it really that big a deal? And I think that summarizes most people's problems. But as for this situation, people related, of course, I was in a situation where I had someone I hired, and there was limited choice. It's a really tough market at the moment, and I thought I could make it work, and it just turned out it wasn't a good fit, and they decided to terminate. And I said, okay, look, bear with me for a bit. I just need to find a replacement. So we came to an agreement. So everything's all good. The problem is, during the hiring process, I came across an individual that I thought presented exceptionally well. Unfortunately, the person had a lot of overlap with somebody that was already in my team that wasn't necessarily a high performer, was in the middle, mainly due to still being a beginner, but had a lot of promise, great attitude, great team fit, and with time would become a high performer. So it almost feels like NBA with draft picks. Anyhow, the situation I was confronted with was I didn't have any additional headcount to hire this exceptional person I met, without trading or getting rid of one of the existing employees. And so I was deliberating whether to terminate or let go of the person that wanted to leave, that I knew really actually didn't want to. It was just more struggling with the consume last, and was having a knee-jerk reaction, or trade my hidden gem, future high performer, to somebody else for their headcount. And to get it started with this exceptional person I met, I decided to make the trade. And as soon as I made that trade and the person agreed, so basically I was going to keep the person that wanted to leave and bring in this new guy, I started getting these gut feelings that I've made a bad decision. But the problem is, I didn't have any options on how to resolve the decision. The purchase orders, etc., had already been processed, so the ball was in motion. Now I had to live with it. So I went through a stressful time figuring out, how am I going to live with this? How am I going to maximize the transaction with this person that was struggling, and how do I deal with this future high performer that really wants to work with me? And how do I manage the potential team culture shit show when the new starter comes in? And I started canvassing some different options, and I decided I need to actually speak to someone. I'm still new to the management game, and I'm always open to new options. And I decided to seek some mentorship. Unfortunately, I chose people that are in my business group, and I was really disappointed, because speaking to these people, being vulnerable, asking for some mentorship on how to weigh up the situation, what I got was people that they saw opportunity. And they offered, instead of providing direct assistance, they provided horse trading, where they wanted to take my people from my team, which is a good sign. I took it as a compliment, to offset my issue. But for me, that wasn't the advisement I was seeking. I still learned a lesson from it, and I'd still be open to talking to those people again. But it's the lesson there is that altruism isn't free or readily available, and that's okay. I'm okay with it. I just wasn't prepared for it at the time. But ironically, as a last resort, I decided to sit down with the person I made the horse trade with in the beginning. I explained the situation. I said, I don't know what to do. And that guy offered me the mentorship I was looking for, and came back down to, how is your team going to deliver the results that you've committed to? And in the end, that made it quite simple for me. It was, I needed to let go of the person that I wanted to leave in the first place. And since then, everything's been easy, no stress. So In this case, the stress wasn't related necessarily to dealing with an individual like it has been in the past. This was more about the long-term ramifications of ability to make commitment, long-term impact to culture, the burden on me, a whole suite of things. And it's worked out really well. Okay. Question number three. What are some problems you see with the world? So every year, I think I say the same thing, give or take. There's no problems with the world. It's with individuals. And for me, I'd feel comfortable leaving it as that. But I can also understand a need to explain it further, because I can also see how statements like that could appear facetious. You know, there's a lot of suffering in the world that we know about, let alone what we don't know about. And of course it makes me uncomfortable to even have awareness of those things. But at the same time, a lot of that perspective comes through the viewpoint of a human being living on this planet. And the questions about the world, an object removed from the human experience. And for that, it's perfect the way it is, whether it's filled with life or not. There's no relevance in the grand scheme of things. And I hope one day that I'm able to look at life today increasingly with the same neutrality as you can, looking at past experiences. I mean, we talk about the extinction of dinosaurs, and it's not necessarily cold, but it's neutral. Wars from the BC era, you know, Alexander, Mongolian Empire, so much devastation, the Crusades. People have got a lot more attachment to World War II because of the proximity of generations to our lifespan. But in the end, 1,000 years from now, it will be viewed no different than the events I was just speaking about. And so I don't see problems with the world. I see problems with our life experience. And of course, there's a lot of things that from a human or life on this planet point of view, I would love to be able to influence in much greater capacity. But are they actual problems with the world? From that neutral point of view, no. Things are the way that they are. And one of the statements that really irritates me that I hear so much is in regards to COVID. Oh, I want things to go back to the way they were. Well, they never will. They never will. Life's changed. You need to accept that and move on. You know, there might be elements of your life that could be restored to how they were, but life itself, no. That ship has long sailed. And there's a beauty in things never being the same. Enjoy what comes next. Tell us about one of the best times of your life. it's an interesting question. There's a lot of experiences that come to me as fun, rewarding, memorable. But when I think about when I deeply think about the best moments, I think about what touches me, what gives me, I've noticed recently, I don't know how long I've been doing it, but I've noticed at least there are certain moments where I feel a compulsion to just touch that heart area. And I would say at the moment, those are the best moments. And typically, the type of moments that just elicit that reaction, that presence, I would say is observing either myself or other people, persevering. This something to me about seeing resilience in play live, where you know there is something somebody is set back by, some sort of challenge, suffering, resilience, and they persevere, they don't give up, they find a way, and they try. They might not even succeed, but they tried and they overcame that mental barrier and pushed themselves to a new possibility. And I find that super rewarding. I see it a lot with my children quite often, and I've seen it with team members at work that I've been coaching through, and even just recently that high performer, that future high performer person I was talking about, I saw them tackle something that they were extremely intimidated by, and seeing them problem solve through the situation and come through, it didn't matter what the outcome was, I found that immensely rewarding, and that gave me self-satisfaction that what I'm doing is following the path that I want to, that I've chosen. Okay. I suppose in my notes, what I've written here as well is the other thing I enjoy, I don't know if it's best times, but I do enjoy, and it often makes me laugh, is when I have my hard fixed assumptions challenged, and there's a secret joy to that, I guess, with the type double feminine sleep. To actually solidify in a position takes a lot of work. In my mind, as a first layer, I actually don't like that being challenged because there's so much effort to get there. But recently, my partner has been able to, not aggressively push, but prod some of those assumptions. And I do fondly recall those moments as really enjoyable and potentially in the best. Okay, tell us about your biggest challenge right now. I don't really know if there is one. I mean, I feel there's lots of areas in my life that could have more tweak balance. I mean, we're talking before an average day week, like getting that self-inquiry moment integrated. But is that a challenge? I mean, I suppose by the English definition it is, but I don't feel there's a challenge in a goal focus sense where I shall complete this task by this date. It's just more that's a the self inquiry is more a horizon, something to strive towards, a philosophy, I suppose. Not a KPI, key performance indicator. I would say in regards to what I feel and know is important to somewhat assimilate and survive in a modern first world country. Once again, a lot of those things are in place and in motion. I live a good life. Everything else is icing on top. So, if I was going to have a goal focus thing, it's definitely I need to lose weight. I can't believe I've come back from a 9-day camping trip and I put on weight. So there you go. Okay, ideal life 10 years from now. I completely agree with my notes that I wrote last night. We'd come back from camping super, super tired. But I knew I had to do this video today. And I wrote first sentence, don't care what it looks like. I don't. I've got no interest in viewing the specifics of life that far out, even 5 years. I've been challenged recently at work that I need to have a much stronger career map for the next 3 to 5 years. But I'm not interested in, and this is for both work and life, I'm not interested in what that future looks like. It's, my notes are, it's irrelevant and out of my control. I wonder if that, if I do feel it's out of my control. Not that I can't influence it, it's just more that I accept there is a lot of luck and randomness in the intersections of how possibilities come together. So what am I interested in, whether it's the career map or the 5-10 year look ahead, is how life comes together, not what specifics. So I don't care that I need to be on this at a house in a certain location. What I care is how my life is lived, and unfortunately then what how you describe ideal life in 10 years is filled with lots of cliches, which is why I don't particularly enjoy talking about this question, because, you know, those type of cliches are, you know, things like resilient, actualized, curious, all those type of motivational drivers. If I could view my 10-year self from afar and say that this individual demonstrates those type of characteristics, I think those would be my ideal life. Then whatever unfolds from having those characteristics is what it is, and is also subject to the nature of your environment. You know, somebody with those characteristics living in the world today would have a completely different quality of life, experience, compared to someone from 10,000 years ago. You know, they're still struggling to find water, and all those type of things. I mean, there might be a shared satisfaction of stopping and seeing the world unfold, but the quality of life component, the what, is would be drastically different. And the same could be said for how whatever the experience will be in 10 years' time, whether the world is still around or not. All right, well, I came here today thinking that this was going to be my last video, that I'd pretty much given up on these type of things, that there wasn't much to give from the questions. I mean, I don't think about them throughout the year at all, but I've actually really enjoyed this, and I'm looking forward to being open to doing this again. Thank you. Bye. Okay, question number one. What is your average day week like? Well, mostly it's... Damn, the view's nice today. I love coming here. Don't do it enough. For whatever reason, I associate this as a place of reflection. Maybe I should build this into my average day week.